Hello students, today's video is in continuation with the previous one. In my previous video, I had taken up till line number 40 of Browning's poem Andrea del Sarto. So today we are going to proceed further. Here are the lines from 41 to 51. Let's have the lines first. There's the bell clinking from the chapel top. That length of convent wall across the way holds the trees safer, huddled more inside. The last monk leaves the garden, days decrease, and autumn grows, autumn in everything. Now here, the narrator is focusing on the view outside the window. As I told you in the previous stanza that twilight is approaching and Andrea along with his wife, both of them are sitting at the window looking at the faisal. Suddenly the evening bell of the church chimes and Andrea says he can hear the bell, the chiming of the bell, which is located at the top of the church. And just describing the view of the church, he says the convent wall, the wall of the church is surrounding, it's holding a lot of trees. That means it is fencing trees. The trees are huddled more inside. The trees are located inside the vicinity of the church. And as the time of twilight is approaching, he could see the last of the monks leaving the garden. Days decrease. Obviously, it's the time of evening and the season is autumn. That just next line he declares that it's the time of autumn. So obviously in the time of autumn, that means in winters, the days decrease, the length of the day decreases. And autumn grows, and it's the time of autumn. He could feel the autumn season in everything. Now these lines have a deeper meaning. See, autumn season, if you just concentrate on this particular season, it's a season when the cold, when the chill is at its peak, and sort of you can say lack of liveliness is there. There is a kind of melancholic tone everywhere. So he says autumn in everything. He could feel autumn like melancholy in everything. Perhaps he himself is having this pessimistic attitude because of the faithlessness of his wife. That's why it is appearing to him as if the nature also is in communion with his feelings. Ah, the whole seems to fall into a shape as if I saw alike my walk and self. Now he is in a reflective mood. He begins to reflect on his life and his doings. He says, now the whole seems to fall into a shape. That means now I have to understand my position in this world. Now the things are becoming clear to me. As if I saw alike my walk and self. It is appearing to him as if he is now able to see clearly the work done by him and he can evaluate his own position in this world. And all that I was born to be and do, a twilight piece. He says, now I can understand why I was born into this world, why God gave me a chance to be born here. And he says, my job is to do a twilight piece. That means God has given him this opportunity to paint, and the tone of the paintings will be a melancholic one. So perhaps you can say he is just justifying whatever is happening in his life by saying that it was already written in his fate. It was predestined to happen. Love we are in God's hand. Now this line is quite philosophical. He says, love, addressing Lucrezia, he says, we are in God's hand. We all are the puppets of God. He makes us do things. We are not free. So whatever we are doing or whatever is happening in our lives, it is just because God wanted it to happen like that. How strange now looks the life he makes us lead. He says, now I am in a position that I can reflect on this fact. And how strange it appears to me that, see, the life, the kind of life that he has given me to lead. So free we seem, so fettered fast we are. He says, in this life, though we people seem free, we feel as if we are free, but we are fettered fast. We are in chains. See, God is our master. He is actually making us do things. Though we have this notion in our minds, we humans have this notion in our minds that we are free, but in reality, it is not like that. Actually, we all are fettered fast. We all are chained. And what kind of chain is that? See, we all have a limited lifespan. So that is a kind of chain. God has already decided our lifespan. And not only our lifespan, whatever we are doing, though we feel that it is our will which is making us do those things, but in reality, it is actually the will of God that prevails. So, these lines are quite philosophical. Beginning with the description of the surroundings, he ends these lines on a very philosophical observation that we all are mere puppets in the hands of God, and it is actually God who is making us do the things. Now, let's proceed further. I feel he laid the fetter, let it lie. He says, now I feel, now I have understood that it is God who has made these fetters, who has made these chains. Let it lie. And I'm not going to do anything to remove those chains. Let it lie. I am ready to accept. See, there is no other option. We human beings are totally helpless when it comes to God. So he says, I know that I am fettered. I know that I am chained. But let it lie. I'm not going to just oppose, protest. I'm going to do whatever God wants to do me. Whatever God wants me to do. This chamber, for example. He says, for example, just look at this chamber. Chamber here stands for the studio where he is actually has his paintings and where he is sitting in the company of his beloved, his wife. He says, look at the paintings in this studio. Turn your head, all that's behind us. You just have a look. Just turn your head. He is telling Lucrezia to look around. And he says, all that's behind us. Just have a look. What is there behind us? You don't understand. He knows very well that his wife does not have any taste for his paintings. Neither she is able to understand the theme, the tone of his paintings. Because earlier he has very well, pointed towards the fact that she is only interested in the monetary benefits that he gets by selling his paintings. So he says, you don't understand nor care to understand about my art. He says, neither you understand nor you want to actually understand my paintings. But you can hear at least when people speak. See, there are two ways of judging a thing, whether the thing is good or bad. There are two things. Either the person is in a position to judge the thing, For example, suppose a person has got a very keen knowledge of painting, so he can very well judge the painting whether it is good or bad. The second thing is, the person does not have the first hand knowledge about that thing, but at least he can form an opinion by listening to the what other people are saying or commenting on that thing. So that's what he's saying. He says, you don't understand nor care to understand about my art. Lucrezia, you don't understand, you don't know what actually is the tone of my painting or how beautiful my painting is. You don't understand, neither you ever cared to understand, but you can hear at least when people speak. He says, at least you can hear, you can listen to what people are saying, commenting, complimenting my paintings. So when they compliment my paintings, at least you can form an opinion about my paintings. And that cartoon, the second from the door, it is the thing. Now he points towards a very particular painting. It's actually a cartoon, and it is hanging second from the door. It is very near to the exit, second number. So he says, it is the thing. Now, it is the thing. That means it is really a beauty. Probably the painting is exceptionally well painted by him. So that's why he is just underlining the fact. He says, it is the thing. Love. So such things should be. He says, actually, this is what art is. He has painted a cartoon, and it is hanging near the door. He says, it is actually a very good painting. Love, so such things should be. Behold, Madonna, I'm bold to say. Addressing his wife, he says, behold, Madonna. Oh, my love, oh, beautiful lady, just behold that painting. Just look at that painting. I'm bold to say, I have the courage, I have the guts to say that such things should be. That means paintings should be like this one. He's so much impressed with his own painting. Probably that painting is quite exceptionally good. So pointing towards that special painting which was hanging second from the door, he says, it is the thing, it is actually a marvelous painting. So, oh beautiful lady, just have a look at that painting. And he admits that it is actually the qualities that are being reflected by that painting, these are the chief qualities that should be in a painting if a painter wants recognition in his life for his paintings. So that's all for today. Go through the videos, watch the videos very carefully. And students, if in case you have any problem, just WhatsApp me about that.